Today is Wednesday, May 13th, 2009. Hi, I'm John Williams from WGN Radio, which stands for the world's greatest newspaper. That's the Chicago Tribune. And Tribune columnists Eric Zorn and Mary Schmich are here. Hi, guys.
Morning, John.
Okay, so what's number one on your agenda?
So too much rehearsal this morning. and we're sort of burned out. Well, we wanted to talk about this California, Miss USA story.
Right. No, I didn't.
Mary didn't.
You
know,
boys
Mary,
did.
You would, because, but that's an inappropriate response because this isn't about TNA. This is about how America loves a controversy even when there is none. There's no issue here.
Who's
that's
America?
New.
You know, I've managed to ignore this story because I just don't care. I mean, I've seen the headlines around. I truly don't know what it's about. So give me 10 seconds. Tell us what it's about.
Eric, do it.
And then we will manufacture opinions.
Well, here it is. Miss California said she thinks that marriage should be for heterosexual couples. Fine. There was a little controversy about
right.
that.
Right. I was in on that controversy.
But then this baby got legs because, as it turns out, her boobs were paid for by the California pageant to give her more confidence. And then it was revealed that she had revealing photos. So Donald Trump had to go look at them. And Trump decided that they were...
I did too, by the way. I felt it only my duty to look at those photos.
And Trump has decided that they're okay for America and she gets to keep her crown. Now you're up to speed.
And what's the controversy?
I think ultimately it's whether or not gays should marry. I mean, it really does.
Right, and we've already discussed that.
I know we
have.
Are
we done?
We've been discussing that for 20 years,
but we've discussed
changed.
It in the context of this beauty pageant.
But we've also been discussing the propriety of beauty pageant contestant behavior since Vanessa Williams, right?
I mean, but here's what I think matters, Eric. Don't you agree? She expressed an opinion, and she's being criticized for it. I don't even agree with her opinion, but I so support her right to say it. That
so do I.
I'm bristling at the notion that you'll be excluded from something because you have a particular personal belief.
Well, I was totally on her side on all this until I heard what she was saying yesterday at her news conference where she was saying, you know, I had my First Amendment right to express and I used my right and I was punished for that right. And in fact, she wasn't punished for that. There are rules that as Miss California USA she's supposed to follow.
They even they got standards.
And she and
but it wasn't,
she
really
wasn't
about the First
punished
Amendment.
For it. She's not supposed to get involved in these political issues, which is fine. I mean, she answered the question during the pageant. That
they
was
brought
fine.
It up. They brought it
they
up.
They brought it up, but then she's persisted and she's gone to Washington. She's apparently blowing off Miss California obligations to express her opinion, to become this political figure. That breaks the rules.
I know.
And she's not being punished.
Mary's dinging
this. Okay,
out.
That's the end of this topic. We've discussed it. Now let's move on to something really serious. Playboy magazine.
Okay, fine.
It's not a change of subject.
I think it's a sign of the apocalypse is what it is because it's changing. Go ahead, Mary. What is your
take? Well, you know, I mean, the big story this week, one of the big stories, the most popular story on our news site yesterday, I think, was that Playboy magazine is in trouble, which we've known for some time, that they're going to have to change the way they put out a magazine. And, you know, it is interesting, I think, to just think about the place that Playboy has had in our culture for so long. And I mean, it seems overdue, honestly, that they're acknowledging that the world has changed around them, much as it's changed around newspapers. And that, you know, that kind of tee-hee, hide it under the bed, hide it in the closet, hide it in the drawers thing that used to go along with owning Playboy. It's over. It's all on the internet.
Big part of my life growing
up. And worse.
I mean, as far as all that goes. I mean, it was one of those, Playboy magazine was one of the, was contraband when I was, you know, 12 years old and passing them around and hiding them from our parents.
Where'd you get them?
People's older brothers was generally how that happened. They would get passed down and passed around. And just the fact that, you know, we're talking, you know, 35, 40 years ago that this was an important cultural thing, means that it's highly unlikely that it would remain relevant. And I don't really even know what niche it fills anymore.
Well, I'll tell you the niche it fills, and I'm sorry that it's passed. Because you're right, Mary, it's so much worse now. You don't have to have a magazine hidden under the mattress. You can go on the internet. But the internet doesn't have much soft porn. It has triple X porn. So you go from seeing primetime television and an occasional sexy starlet or scene to hardcore pornography. And Playboy is so safe by the standards of the internet that I'd rather my kid look at the Playboy magazine than surf the internet for pictures of women. You know what I mean? I mean, I don't know of any soft, I don't know of the Playboy equivalent
Have you checked it out?
Well, Playboy Online, their website is more hardcore than their magazine, really? I think.
So I'm told.
Okay, so that's my take on that. Can I bring up a different topic?
Yeah.
It, more related to the first one. What was your take on Bristol Palin's coming out against having unprotected or premarital sex?
I think that someone in her position, she, you know, Bristol Palin, daughter of Sarah Palin, who was impregnated, right?
Just sure.
That she
had a baby.
She has an interesting story to tell, a cautionary tale to tell, right?
Yeah.
To people. I think she has to be careful how she tells that tale.
She has no credibility on this subject. It only matters when you're not pregnant and you haven't had premarital sex, but she did.
Well, no, I disagree with that. I do think that there are lessons to be learned and shared from making mistakes. You know, that the most authentic lessons actually come from making mistakes. The problem with the Palin family is that their credibility as a family is undermined on this issue.
Because of her mother.
Yeah, because, you know, there was the whole message that was projected by Sarah Palin and her camp about this issue before Bristol was pregnant.
And there, you know, and her whole thing about abstinence is the only way to be sexually active, is the only way not to get pregnant, is not even true. I mean, there are lots of non-intercourse sexual activities that teens can engage in that don't get them pregnant.
Well, when I was in high school, all the girls knew them in Catholic high school.
But parents don't want kids to not get pregnant. Parents want kids to not have sex. If you told your teenagers, listen, you can have sex, or if they told you, I can have sex in some magical way that absolutely 100% guarantees I won't get pregnant, would you still not want them to have sex? I think parents are hung up on the act as much as they are on the outcome. But that's beside the point, too. I think that Bristol Palin saying don't have sex is like Keith Richards saying don't take drugs, or Mick Jagger. And then
on the other hand, I think Keith Richards is testament to don't take drugs.
Or you'll be like me. No, because living rock and roll stars, again, have no credibility in this game. Kurt Cobain does. Cobain's not an example. He didn't die of a drug overdose. But to me, then you say, wow, they get to live the dream. They had the rock and roll, they had the sex, they had the drugs, and they had it all. And their face is craggly. But they're still getting the girls and they're still having the drugs. And when they say, don't do it, trust me, I know what I'm talking about. I'm thinking, you seem to have managed just fine.
Now, both of you have sons of a certain age. Have you had discussions with your sons about how you think they should conduct themselves sexually?
Yes.
Is this too personal?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
No, I can answer that. Have you?
Yeah.
I told my son, I want you to be first and foremost safe and responsible.
And did you tell him how?
Exactly, yeah. No, I said, I don't want you having sex. If you do, I want you to have safe sex. That's a mixed message. I'm happy to do that because the stakes are so high. I mean, you can get AIDS or you can get somebody pregnant. Your life or somebody else's life can change so radically. I don't think you can say, please don't have sex. You have to at least arm them with information. Hell, give them a box of condoms for all I care. But I don't think you can hide and hope that they're going to be okay because you don't know.
Yeah,
you have to be responsible. And by that, I mean not abstinence. I mean smart and safe.
Yeah, right. And that was totally the substance of my message as well, which was responsibility for yourself and for your partner and responsibility and respect. And obviously, I mean, one of the things, it's abstinence only program doesn't work statistically, and I think it's a foolish message to try to give to kids. I mean, one of the things about the sex education that I got when I was a teenager was abstinence was never discussed, and I think that that's a positive development in our culture that we were told about all the devices and so on and the consequences, but we were never really given abstinence.
Wow,
as an option.
You grew up in a totally different universe than I did.
Why? What
did you
do?
Well, I went to Catholic schools, and abstinence was the only thing.
Really?
And you know, now that I'm old, I do wish that there were a way to convince high school people, especially, that this is probably not the best thing for them to be doing.
Having sex.
Yeah. I do think there's an argument to be made for abstinence. However, that argument, I mean, I looked at my own high school and saw how often that argument failed. And because there was no information, because there was so much fear of parents talking to children and children talking to parents, that, you know, people made these one-time mistakes and then, you know, The lifetime consequence.
Yeah, I mean, my real battle on this is the only part of abstinence education. I think abstinence should be part of any comprehensive sex education. But if you're telling kids abstinence only, and we're not even going to talk about this other stuff because you'd never, ever do it, I think it's unrealistic and damaging. So that's...
Ding, what was the other topic that you guys wanted to talk about that we haven't talked about?
Well, if we want to go right to the entertainment portion or the recommendations or endorsements, whatever, I'm reading a book called Outliers. Have you read that book?
I know. I've got the book. I haven't read it.
Help me out. What's the author's name? The Blink and Turning Point, Tipping Point.
Oh, Malcolm Gladwell.
Malcolm Gladwell, yeah.
Yeah, Brenda read it. I'm starting it.
Anyway, it's all about success. It's all about how we look at people who are successful and we think, oh, they were just geniuses. Or, oh, they just worked really hard. And that's how they got where they were. And he talks about how these people who are, by outliers, he means people who are just, like Bill Gates, someone who just doesn't really fit into the continuum. And he shows how much this combination of hard work and luck and, all these different elements play into success. And it's a fascinating way to think about success and about when you look at people who make it where they are and you look at your own life. We have three of us around this table here. How did you get to where you were? Was it a lot of hard work?
Good looks in my case.
Well, in your case, yeah. But that was luck, right?
I think it is always interesting to see what people attribute their success to, mm-hmm. which may not be exactly what led to their success, but we all have a story that we create about, what got me here.
Well, Gladwell makes the argument that one of the reasons Bill Gates is successful was when he was born. He was born at exactly the right time to latch on to this computer revolution. I mean, that if he had been born a couple of years earlier, he probably would have been too old. Or later, yeah. He wouldn't have been in that situation. So anyway, it's just a fascinating book.
Outliers.
It's not long. Outliers. Very good.
How about you, Mary?
An oldie goldie. The Lincoln Park Zoo. I went walking through it the other day. I mean, I often do, but I hadn't in a while. And it is just in gorgeous springtime glory. They've enhanced certain parts of it. And when I started thinking that I wanted to recommend it, I was walking past the flamingos and the waterfowl pond and just all of these trees in bloom and weeping willow and people of all kinds there, but not too many. Sometimes it can get too crowded. But just, the whole globe converges in this beautiful, free, scenic place in Chicago.
I'm reading Greg Kot's new book, Ripped.
I heard you talk to him.
About halfway through it. And if you're into music, or even not, into media, or just want to get a good take on what's happening in contemporary culture through your computer, Ripped, about how the music industry is changing, everything from iTunes to Napster and LimeWire, remember that? It's fascinating how the bands make money, don't make money, who is, who isn't, how it's jockeying for position. It's really an interesting time in that industry. And Kot, of course, has got his finger right on it. So Ripped by Greg Kot comes out on Tuesday.
On the download button. So next week, I'm not going to be here next week for the podcast, by the way. So you guys are going to have to do it alone or get a guest.
It'll be our best one ever.
We can talk about it.
That's it for this week. We'll do it again next.